In previous videos, I've shown schematics with two capacitors in parallel. It's always a bigger electrolytic capacitor in parallel with a relatively tiny ceramic capacitor. One of the most common questions I get is, why do you do this? It's such an insignificant amount of extra capacitance. Why not just use a single larger capacitor? This video is going to show you in detail the effects that choosing the wrong type of capacitor can have. The short answer is that different types of capacitors behave completely differently at different frequencies. This is not something they teach you in school, and if you don't know it, you're going to get nowhere with electronics. When you first hear about capacitors, you learn that they allow alternating current to pass through them. The problem is this ideal capacitor doesn't actually exist in real life. Actual capacitors will have unwanted resistance and inductance that comes from all the different materials that are used to put them together. Even the leads going to the capacitor itself will have a non-trivial amount of resistance and inductance. So, because of how capacitors are made, a real-world capacitor behaves a lot more like this. There are other capacitor models, but this is the one most relevant to this video. In the middle, we have the actual capacitance. In series with it, we have two non-ideal parameters called ESL and ESR. This is the equivalent series inductance and equivalent series resistance created by all the different physical materials used to make the capacitor. As you already know, resistors resist current at all frequencies, and inductors will impede alternating current. The higher the frequency, the higher the impedance. So the ESR and ESL limit the capacitor's ability to act as a high-pass filter and pass high-frequency current. Both these capacitors are 10 microfarads. Intuitively, which capacitor do you think has the higher ESR and ESL? The 10 microfarad electrolytic capacitor with the 1-inch wire leads, or the tiny 10 microfarad ceramic capacitor? The tiny ceramic will have lower ESR and ESL, and that's why even though both these capacitors are rated at 10 microfarads, the ceramic one will perform much better at high frequencies in real-world applications. We can quantify this difference with a graph called an impedance curve. You can see that at low frequencies, under 1 kHz, all capacitors perform pretty much the same. As the frequency of the alternating current increases, the impedance decreases linearly as you'd expect. But above a few kilohertz, different capacitors start behaving really differently. You can see that this electrolytic capacitor is basically useless above 3 kilohertz. But the ceramic capacitor has a linearly decreasing impedance all the way into the megahertz range. Now this is interesting. Because the ceramic capacitor has a certain ESL, once you get into the really high frequencies, the inductance really starts affecting things, and impedance actually goes up. So after a certain point, you start picking out capacitors not for their capacitance value, but based on their equivalent series inductance and equivalent series resistance. Okay, enough theory. I want to show you a practical example. Here I have a simple buck converter evaluation board. It's designed by Texas Instruments themselves, so it's reasonable to assume that the component choices and PCB layout is going to be good. I'm giving it 10 volts on the input, and it's spitting 3.3 volts on the output, and there's a light 650 milliamp load on it. I'm going to probe the output voltage with my oscilloscope and see how clean the output of this supply is. You can see that we've got about 40 millivolts peak to peak of AC ripple and noise on top of the 3.3 volt DC output. Not bad, that's about 1.2% of the output voltage. If we take a look at the schematic, we can see that they use two 47 microfarad ceramic capacitors in parallel on the output to achieve this. A total of 94 microfarads. So, here's an idea. Let's increase the capacitance on the output, and that should provide more filtering, and the circuit will perform even better. Let's get rid of those ceramic capacitors and replace them with a single 220 microfarad electrolytic capacitor. That's more than double the capacitance, so we should get less than half the noise, right? Wow, so yeah, that's definitely more than 40 millivolts. The output has 330 millivolts peak to peak of ripple, which is abysmal. That's 10% of the DC output of 3.3 volts, and nothing that runs off of 3.3 volts would be happy with that. So you get the idea. Electrolytic capacitors are basically useless at filtering out high frequencies. And that's why in switch mode power supplies, they either use ceramic or tantalum capacitors, Or sometimes designers put electrolytic and ceramic in parallel to cheaply get a combination of high capacitance and low ESR and low ESL. I chose to do an example with a power supply because the effects are really obvious. But you can get problems in other circuits too. Sometimes amplifiers can become unstable and start randomly oscillating if you don't add a ceramic bypass capacitor. And digital designs need ceramic caps too. If a processor has a 32 MHz clock frequency, you've got millions of little transistors in there being switched at 32 MHz, and a big aluminum electrolytic capacitor with a ton of series inductance is going to be completely useless at keeping the voltage stable. And if the voltage going to the microcontroller is unstable, things can get glitchy, your analog measurements can be wrong, it just creates a ton of problems. Here are some more examples from the official Raspberry Pi schematic. Notice how it always seems to be this very particular value, 100 nanofarads. Why 0.1 microfarads? What is it about 100 nanofarads that's so damn special? Shouldn't you be choosing caps according to the frequency of what you're trying to filter? Well, yes, in theory you should. And for some applications, you have to. If you're designing a 5 GHz Wi-Fi system, you might find that the right capacitor to use is 100 picofarads, because even a 100 nanofarad ceramic capacitor will have too much inductance. But let's assume you aren't designing RF circuitry for a second. For low-powered things like op-amps, microcontrollers, and digital logic chips, 0.1 microfarads is going to work just fine 99.9% of the time. It'll filter out the high-frequency garbage, and it might end up being overkill, but given that these things literally cost a penny or two, it's not worth spending even 5 minutes trying to figure out whether 33 nanofarads or 47 nanofarads is the theoretically optimal value. So every designer just ends up throwing 100 nanofarads onto the low-powered chips in their design. Thank you for watching. Now you should have a better idea of what capacitors to use in different situations.